The Orthodox Art of Surviving videos. Black and white. Black madness and white madness.
All events of the world, everything, shows that we are living in the apostasy times, of which the Holy Apostle Paul speaks immediately before the coming of the Antichrist. Mostly, this is shown by the apostasy of the hierarchy. Priests and bishops, who are such already in name only, and have only a guise of godliness, only externally, for filthy lucre, but denying the power thereof. The hierarchy, which is apostatizing, prizes priests, hypocrites, apostates, and thus, this hierarchy of apostates invites the Antichrist to come, calls him to come, and serves the Antichrist both with this and with the fact that it victimizes and ridicules the true piety, victimizes the few remaining true priests and laymen, and so the way of truth is evil spoken of as predicted. Thus it is through the apostatizing priests and bishops hypocrites, who not only do not enter the kingdom of heaven themselves, but also do not allow others to go in. It is through them that the beast which comes out of the abyss chases into the wilderness. The Holy Orthodox Church persecutes her, persecutes the woman who is crying in travail, and who is bringing forth everyone who is born in Christ. The beast, through the apostates, and personally, exactly her, chases into the wilderness, where she has a place prepared of God, who will feed her 3 years and a half, or 42 months, or 1260 days. Here in Greece, every second monk in the Holy Mountain, or rather zealot of the Orthodoxy, makes a fuss around himself. He says, on the coming of the Antichrist, we will go to the mountains. In Greek, apostasy. Very pompous words. But when I ask one or another of them, have you lived there in extreme conditions, which would be the case with anyone who went to the mountains so suddenly? Until now, not one has answered to me that he has. And when I ask them again, well, then how are you going to make it in such circumstances, you and the people who follow these calls of yours? Usually still so pompously and confidently, they answer, God will help us. However, they take no measures to apply their human zeal to God's help, which they expect from the Lord. These noisy and full of pride leaders will be the first ones who will despair and give up when they see that God is not helping them. Why? Because God does not encourage the proud one, the slothful, or the lazy. So it is not enough just to shout and show how great believers we are. It is necessary also to apply some effort to the help which we expect God to send us. We need to do some preparation on our part too, and this is called synergy. At least, we must show our diligence, our human effort, before our Lord. This is what the Lord wants from us.
Tigre.
Personally, I try to keep myself from such conceit, ridiculous self-confidence. I do not want to make such mistakes and irrationality because, from my side, it would be irresponsible. Irresponsibility both to God and to the people who follow me. That's why I must work, I must apply some effort to the help which I expect God to give us, to work in synergy with God. Therefore, in my humble abilities, I endeavor to share here in brief my experience in the catechumen life and the experience which I gained back in my student years in scientific expeditions with my fellow students in extreme conditions. I don't say I'm a specialist of surviving. No, I don't dare to say that. Didasco aedios comenos, as Saint Basil the Great says. Yes, I'm teaching others, it's my duty, but I'm always learning myself too. In my student years, as one of my fellow students from my youth, is now Professor Christo Pimpirev. With him, with Milan Kuzov and other friends, we began our expeditions together, but later we parted ways. Christo became a big man, a hero of science, and I'm really proud of him. He built a polar station at the South Pole. Milan Kuzov preferred art to the science of geology and became a talented filmmaker in Bulgarian TV and won international awards. So we do not consider him a traitor of wilderness. I took my monastic and priesthood path, so now we are talking with you about salvation. But in those years, since my specialty in university was another, my task in the expedition was, while the geologists collect samples, I was to take care of the camp and, if needed, of the food. So when they return, they have something to eat and a place to relax. The most experience I've gained since then,
and the great desire,
hope will serve us with the help of God above all else. The Orthodox Art of Surviving, OAS, in this direction I work today. It very much sounds insane. I know, many will be the people who will regard it as such, but why? What do you think? What will be the appearance of the Orthodox monasteries in the future, as long as the world has future? What you used to see? Stone walls, black clouds, right? Because I'm not convinced it's so. Now here I'm gonna show you Catherine. She's one of my spiritual daughters. And she sold her home in order that with the money she could buy two plots of land. On the one, to found a convent in which would live she with her daughter. To come also her mother, also another nun. She's my spiritual daughter and she is ill in bed for 20 years now.
And also my mother, who is 87 years old now and lives in the United States.
And the other plot, about 3 kilometers away, to make a skitty for me, because I cannot live in a convent for women. Well, some do live in convents, priests and bishops, but I want everything to be strictly by the rules. Here is Ekaterina. Looks like a nun in this apparel. No? Excellent. So the camouflage is good. By the way, the Catholic nuns live like farmers.
So do not expect to see anything outwardly resembling a monastery in a form in which you are used to see it. You would rather see some sort of a teepee camp, close to this camp, a settlement of laymen who have come here to exercise the Orthodox art of surviving. Call it an Indian village if this suits you more. Others do not come at all. They directly live in this area. They have their own plots of land, they have put up their own teepees there and constantly live in them. No stone dwellings, only teepees. In extreme cases, wooden structures and, at that, rolling on wheels.
Thank you. Това е дивия звяр в пустинята, така е.
Майка ми е първата, която си получи индианското име и го прие с радост.
Какво е това?
Или... Я, нали, Параскева се казва и Паша на Галено се казва.
Да.
Като малко момиченце, но още по-галено се казвали Пашанка.
Аха.
И тя си, я, нали, знае там големите, великите вождове там. Тока и то...
Танка Ютанка.
Да, и аз викам, майко, ти си Пашанка Ютанка. Тя го пили. Така, давай сега. Къде е върха?
Never use metal poles for teepee. During this tour, there is a danger of lightning strike on the teepee. Use wood or bamboo or plastic pipe PVC. In this first test of this mini teepee, we use rebar because we test only the canvas for necessary adjustments. And at that moment, we had no other poles for the test. But it turned into a good reason to give you this valuable instruction. Thanks God.
Ау, кора! Опет я увожда! Посмели я суфиле, ти кара! Джен!
Шо? Какво става?
Новото типи. Игра, айде, игра. Научена.
Та не очакваше такова развитие.
Welcome to our madness.
General, everybody, sit down. Good boy.
This is the beginning of the
end.
End. Mad inhabitants of this mad world, come to our madness to get out of yours. The right way to get life. Man must go mad once again to get cured of the madness. Blaise Pascal, France.
An old Cherokee is teaching his grandson about life. A fight is going on inside me, he said to the young man. It is a terrible fight, and it is between two wolves. One wolf is evil. He is envy, jealousy, sorrow, regret, greed, arrogance, self-pity, guilt, resentment, inferiority, lies, false pride, superiority, and ego. He continued, the other wolf is good, joy, peace, love, hope, serenity, humility, kindness, benevolence, empathy, generosity, truth, compassion and faith. And they are fighting this way in the man until the end of his life. The same fight is going on inside you and inside every other person too. The young man thought about it for a minute and then asked his grandfather, which wolf will win? The old Cherokee simply replied, the one you feed.